Good morning. If you missed church last Sunday, hold up your hand. I'm glad to see you. And as we begin our service, let's sing, Oh, for a Thousand Tongues to Sing. That's be on your screen, and it's page 57 in the Methodist hymnal. Oh, for a thousand tongues to sing. Greet one another. Thank you for remaining standing. Our next hymn is 2068, In the Faith We Sing. I Love You, Lord. We'll sing it twice. you may be seated. The Apostles' Creed is found on 882 in the Methodist hymnal, and we'll join together for that. It'll also be on the screen. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. And I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended to heaven. On the third day, he arose again. He ascended into heaven and seated at the right hand of the Father. And he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Good to see you here this morning, and we join our hearts and our voices in praise and thanksgiving to the Lord. Please take just a moment and fill out the registration pad and pass it down the pew so that everyone will have the opportunity to register your attendance. We appreciate each of you, and if we have those visiting, I can't quite see if we have somebody strange back there in the back, but if you're visiting, we'd like to have your name and address and telephone number. We'd appreciate this so very much. I'd like to call your attention to the beautiful flowers. They were placed in the church in honor of this lady's 80th birthday, Samiko. Good. Well, it won't be long till you have another one. It'll seem like yesterday. I'd like to call your attention now to some of the announcements that we need to make. This afternoon at 4 o'clock will be the women's Bible study. Tomorrow, our church office will be closed for Martin Luther King Day. On Wednesday, our senior luncheon at 11:30, our Bible study at 6, and choir rehearsal at 7. On Thursday, 5:30, our neighborhood cafe. On next Sunday, the United Methodist Men will have their meeting at 7:30 in the community room. And then at 4 o'clock, the women's Bible study again. So these are the announcements I need to bring to you, I think.
Harold?
Yeah.
We also have United Methodist Women tomorrow morning at 10:30.
Okay. I see that. Okay.
I know.
I was afraid to go to that one when I was a pastor. All those women. I didn't have it on my schedule for this week. As we have our morning prayer now, we'd like to remember so many of these people that have a special need. Our call to prayer is something about that name. It's number 171 in the Methodist hymnal, and the response will be, Majesty, worship His Majesty, and that's 176. Let us join our heart together as we pray.
Yeah.
Let us pray. Our Father, as we quiet our minds and our hearts, we pray that you'll speak to each of us and let us feel your presence close as we come together for this time of worship and pray. And Father, we thank you for this place that has been hallowed years ago for holy worship and for those that labored down through the years to maintain this place. And we're especially thankful for each one who's come this morning as we come together this particular time of day on this Sunday to be together, to fellowship, and to worship you. Father, we pray for those in the hospital today. We know that there's many people there that need a special touch. And we pray for those in the nursing home, Father, that we visit from time to time. And we pray, dear Lord, that you'll continue to be near to them. Some have been there for a while, and they'll be there for until they pass on. And we pray that you'll, today, that you'll be their companion. You'll speak to their hearts and let them feel that you're there with them this morning as we lift them up in our prayers. And Father, we pray for the shut-ins at home. So many times we forget these, and we pray, dear Lord, you'll help us to be more concerned for each one. We pray for these families, dear Lord, that has recently lost loved ones. And we pray that you'll comfort their hearts. We know that we can say and do a lot of things, but only you can really and truly comfort them. And we pray that you'll help each of them to look to you for the strength, the courage during this difficult time. Thank you again for our church. We pray a special blessing on our pastor today as he brings our message and unite our hearts and our voices together. And we pray that you'll guide us in all the things that we need to be doing and give us the strength and the courage and the tender mercies that you alone can give us. Father, we thank you and we pray that you'll be with us when we fall short of what you want us to be. Dear Father, so many times we neglect the things that we need to be doing, and sometimes we get carried away with things that take us away from you and from your thoughts and your precious Holy Spirit. And we pray that you'll forgive us for these times and teach us to pray as Jesus taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you. Now we worship with our tithes and offerings. Let us pray. Father, you've blessed us in so many different ways, and now we have the opportunity and the privilege to give back to you. Bless our offering today, we pray, in Christ's name. Amen. Thank you. Our scripture lesson this morning is from Thessalonica, to the people there at Thessalonica, chapter 2, verses 1 through 8. You know, brothers and sisters, that our visit to you was not without results. We had previously suffered and been treated outrageously in Philippi. As you know, but with the help of our God, we dare to tell you his gospel in the face of strong opposition. For the appeal we make does not spring from error or impure motives, nor are we trying to trick you. On the contrary, we speak as those approved by God to be entrusted with the gospel. We're not trying to please people, but God, who tests our hearts. You know we never use flattery, nor did we put on a mask to cover up greed. God is our witness. We were not looking for praise from people, not from you or anyone else, even though as apostles of Christ, we could have asserted our authority. Instead, we were like young children among you, just as nursing mothers cares for her children. So we care for you because we love you so much. We were delighted to share with you not only the gospel of God, but our lives as well. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
There are very few places in the scripture, both Old and New Testament, where scripture gets real personal, very personal. In a few places, the author just doesn't quite get there. They continue to tell about the biblical narrative, the biblical story, and they hardly ever use the word I. But of course, letters just kind of tend to lend themselves to that flavor. And particularly Paul's letters, when he's been from church to church to church with people expecting him to make them happy. It's one of the most touching moments in all of Paul's letters and correspondence. And here in 1 Thessalonians, Paul gets very personal. And we don't expect that. But not only personal, Paul gets very pastoral. And Paul gives us here a rare glimpse of the personal thoughts of the great apostle. We see a number of aspects of the life of Paul. Paul the pastor, Paul the preacher, Paul the establisher of churches, Paul, the maintainer of congregations. Paul, the author of many epistles. So much so that these words relate to the pastoral ministry even today. Oh, sure, we know that Paul had opposition. That's not that uncommon. Most pastors, most preachers have experienced people who did not like them, or they did not like what they did, or they did not like what they did not do. Even Billy Graham had opposition. I wonder when Paul preached a sermon, if people told him that it was just the wrong sermon to preach, because we've all heard that. Or we preached that sermon and so-and-so wasn't here today, you should have saved it until they were. Okay? Is that the way you live your life? I'm just wondering. I wonder when Paul established a new church, if someone said that, Paul, that was in the wrong town. You shouldn't even put a church there. Those people are nasty. They don't even deserve a church. Because I wonder when Paul spent months or years within a church that needed lots of help, although they would not admit it, if the other churches got really jealous of Paul spending so much time there and complained to the district superintendent that he stayed there too long. I wonder, when Paul wrote to other churches and other communities, if the one he was in at the time he wrote the letter complained that he was spending too much time writing letters. An apostle, Paul, may be. But there is plenty of opponents, especially at Philippi, of all places. He writes this beautiful letter to Philippi, and there's a reason for that. He describes writing to the church at Philippi, and when he preached the gospel of God, as he called it, the gospel of God, Paul needed encouragement, support, and faithful people around him to support him. Actually, Paul continually got in trouble because he insisted on speaking the truth in love. Believe me, you can get into a lot of trouble with people when you speak the truth in love, as he wrote to the Ephesians in chapter 4. He writes to his friends in Thessalonica about how he was mistreated at Philippi because he had the courage and the boldness to declare the gospel of God in spite of great opposition. You might even have to forgive Paul for sounding a bit defensive, for he was apparently under attack by some of the opponents, and he felt like he must defend himself against the charge that he was not acting like an apostle, as if the others would know what an apostle might act like. Paul believed that if the truth pleased God, even if it angered people, such is life. For it is far better to please God than to please people anytime. Now, sometimes we learn that, and sometimes we don't. Sometimes it takes a long time to invest in what it takes to learn that message out of 1 Thessalonians. Some of us are still learning that. Sometimes people want you to think that it is your job to please them. It's not going to work that way. Life is never that simple. The passage that Paul's letter says that the primary image of the Christian leader is one of courage. Courage in the face of opposition. Courage in the face of whatever opposes the will of God. And a Christian leader speaks the word of God so that it pleases God and not necessarily all the people listening. And so the third idea in Paul's letter to the church at Thessalonica is that a leader in Christ maintains the spirit of openness and honesty. Sometimes we aren't sure we want our Christian leaders and preachers to do all those things. When some folks are used to leading and intimidating and dominating control over a group of people, it is very difficult for the primary metaphor of the pastoral leadership to be one of healing and hope and hospitality. An invitation to spiritual growth. You know you're in trouble when you say, we're going to have a conversation or Bible study or sermon about spiritual growth. Well, I'm not coming. I don't need that. Okay, there's a clue. Leadership in the church is a mutual task. It takes more than one person. It is never left to the preacher. All of us are called to be cooperative and helpful, not judgmental. Paul appealed to the church at Thessalonica for support. Paul was asking for loyalty among his congregation. Paul was asking for the people of God to focus on what God wanted them to do. And there were some nearby preachers who would flatter their members so they would be called upon. They would tell the church members what they wanted to hear. They would try their best not to make waves. They would allow the loudest person to become the leader by default. And some of them, as they sought to praise the mortals, would become greedy for the best pulpits in town. It's all in the Bible. This is nothing new. Preachers in the early church, even in the churches Paul established, like Thessalonica, sometimes would not exactly tell the truth to their people. They would make every attempt to get the best pulpits, and they would preach and say what the people wanted to hear. That was not the way Paul preached the message of the gospel of God. Paul spoke with the truth in love, as he told the church in Ephesus to do that. Preaching from the beginning of time has always found it easier to comfort the afflicted than to afflict the comfortable. Avoiding the painful truth almost always leads to bigger churches and higher salaries. Speaking the truth in love may hurt a few people, but it almost always leads to the cross and every heartache in between. Paul's words to the Thessalonians are perhaps the most personal words we have from him. And there's no wonder about that, because you feel his frustration and his pain at continually facing rejection by telling the truth about God. Others are more successful. When he sort of grumps a little bit, people think, well, what's Paul grumping about? Oh, I don't know. It could be the way the church is treating him. Preachers always find success when they seek praise from people rather than God. Preachers will always find success when they try to please people rather than God. And then let's try for another metaphor. Moses went up on the mountain to find out what God wanted him to say to the people. And God told him, and you better write this down so you don't forget by the time you get to the bottom of the mountain. So when he got back down the mountain to the people, he heard them singing and shouting and having too much fun, and they drowned out his voice as Moses was trying to tell them what God said. So the people of God could not hear the message of God from the messenger of God because they were talking too loud and not willing to listen. Don't interrupt me when I'm having a party. Won't that preach? Moses resisted learning the dance for people who wanted to dance. Moses, like Paul, wanted to teach the people a new dance and a new song. But the people in front of Moses, like the people listening to Paul, found the steps of the new dance a little too difficult to master. There was too much work involved to be obedient to God. And not only that, the people were talking and arguing with one another so much so that they couldn't even begin to hear the words of the song or the words of the Ten Commandments. And the truth is that God wanted those people to change. The truth is, God wants us to turn to God's ways rather than the ways of the world. The truth is that God wants us to live so as to please God and not the crowd that we're in. And far too often we forget that. The truth is that God wants us to love our neighbors even though we don't always please people within our crowd, by loving our neighbors, or feeding our neighbors, or including our neighbors, or inviting our neighbors. Everybody almost knows Romans 12, 1 and 2. But I want to read to you from the Message, Eugene Peterson's translation of the Bible. So here's what I want you to do. God helping you. Take your everyday, ordinary life, your sleeping, your eating, going to work, and walking around, and place it before God as an offering. Embrace what God does for you, and that is the best thing you can do for Him. Don't become so well adjusted to your culture that you fit into your culture without even thinking. Instead, fix your attention on God. You'll be changed from the inside out. Readily recognize what God wants from you and quickly respond to it. Unlike the culture around you, always dragging you down to the level of immaturity, God brings the best out of you and develops well-formed maturity in you. The truth is that God wants us to be transformed by the spiritual truth rather than the truth fit into our own hopes and dreams and desires and selfish motives. The truth is that we must embrace the unfamiliar ways that God would rather us do than what makes us comfortable. The truth is that we must be willing to give something up rather than hold on to everything that makes us happy, or hold on to the way we've always done it. If we are truly doing the work of God, the likelihood is that we might not please people who think it is the preacher's job to please people, or the lay leader's job to please people, or the church council's job to please everybody in the church, or the finance committee's job to please everybody, or the chair of the pastor parish relations committee, who certainly will never be able to please people. The spiritual truth of this passage in 1 Thessalonians brings both good news and bad news to us. The good news is that God can use us and that God will use us. The bad news is that we will have to get rid of some stuff first. Like our jealousy, like, I don't know, our bitterness, like our judgmentalism, like our Phariseeism. We must be transformed before we can be useful to the kingdom of God. We all need to get rid of that stuff that keeps us from doing what God wants us to do. This passage makes me think of a book I read over 30 years ago, written by a Methodist minister who wrote 50 books over his lifetime, Dr. Lyle Schaller. The book, way back then, was called The Change Agent. And it said all of us could be change agents in the church. It was not well received back then. If told you how important it was to help people to move from point A to point B in their lives and in the church, the change agent. But over the years, I've noticed that people aren't so easily changed, especially when they don't want to be changed. Over the years, I've noticed that people aren't so easily changed because they don't think they need changing. They know people who need changing. They can identify people who need changing. They've made a list of people who need changing, and they're not on the list. And sad as that is, many people don't ever change. They want everyone else to change. What Paul writes about in this passage today is how he deals with his own failures and frustrations in the ministry. He tells the Thessalonians that he loves them, but that doesn't keep Paul from realizing that he is in opposition and they are confronting him and they're not being very nice. Perhaps the Thessalonians thought it was Paul's job to please them. Perhaps they thought that that's what they paid him for. Not that they paid him. Perhaps they were wrong. Perhaps it was Paul's job to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ, to challenge people to be obedient to Christ. Perhaps it was Paul's job to follow Jesus' teachings and to get other people to follow Jesus' teachings. Perhaps there is no one who can please people anyway. No pastor will ever make you happy because happiness has to come from within. Perhaps it is your job to do more than just talk the talk. Perhaps your job is to do your very best and walk the walk. Let us pray. Gracious God, sometimes we get so wrapped up in ourselves, we forget why we're here. We forget what you want us to do. We forget how much you want us to love people who are deemed unlovable. We forget what you are calling us to do, to bring healing and hope and hospitality to the kingdom in this place, at this time, in this community. Accept our hearts, O Lord, as we do exactly what you want us to do with the love of Jesus in our hearts. We pray in his holy name. Amen. We're going to sing the first stanza of our closing hymn, number 407. Go from this place with the love of God in your heart. Go from this place with the challenge that goes along with the teachings of Jesus. Go from this place and love everyone you touch on this day. In the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, amen.